Gonna get freaking everything. Gonna get the birds coming past and everything.
Be like the pigeon lady out of Home Alone. That's my envision.
That's basically anybody's dream, isn't it?
I know.
This is all these like little funny bits are gonna play at the start, and then we're gonna hit them with a knowledge bomb. It's like, you learn. Hello and welcome to Camera Central Podcast. Today I've got Sophie from Ebb and Flow Marketing. She helps us out with a lot of our social media presence stuff, and I thought it would be a really good idea for you guys to learn a little bit about social media and talk about it in general and stuff, really. Can you introduce yourself, explain what you do as well. Okay. I know I kind of just did it, but you're probably going to do it much again. Better than I do.
It's fine.
The Camera Central Podcast is available both on Spotify and YouTube, so make sure you like, follow and subscribe if you want to see more. Let's get back into it, shall we?
My name is Sophie. I own a social media and marketing agency based in Cardiff. We specialise in full service social media management predominantly, but we also do consulting, content and social media training, influencer management and partnerships. Pretty much everything to do with marketing you could imagine.
I mean, that's ideal really. There's a lot of different kind of areas to kind of like uncover there. When it comes to content creators in general, what do you think is the state of social media at the moment?
I mean,
a broad question.
Well, yeah, if you've seen those memes where people are just crying, there's a video recently actually of like a bunch of grown men in a pool going through like some sort of breathwork session and they're just crying. That is a visual representation of what it's like to work in social at the moment, I think. It's a really difficult market to crack for anyone. I think for businesses, it's becoming increasingly more difficult. I think because the focus is on content creators and helping them succeed and them helping them monetize their content, work with brands, obviously that pumps more money back into the platforms. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the key focus. The creators are in a real advantage point because they've got this opportunity to grow quite, I wouldn't say easily, but with, you know, a lot of scope for growth. Businesses have almost got a bit of a glass ceiling at the moment, and it's really quite difficult to crack. The kind of need for paid advertisement has increased a lot. So yeah, it's not a tough gig anymore.
No, it's not a tough gig anymore. So it's easy, is it? No, it's a very hard thing to crack. I mean, when it comes to anything kind of like social media, I mean, we had one viral post a little while back, but when it comes to actually something to expand, it's quite hard to really engineer that. What do you think? Well, I guess that's a good question for you. Do you think it's hard to engineer virality, or is it something that you have to really study?
I don't think it should be anyone's goal, and that's going to be a bit controversial.
That's a really interesting point of view.
It's ultimately what happens when you go viral is, I mean, it can go a lot of different ways, right? But usually what happens is you have no control over the audience that then hits, and it's a real wide audience. Now, the problem with that is that for a business especially, you can then attract an audience of people that are not interested in your business, your brand, your product, your service.
2 seconds. People just inconveniencing us. It's just annoying.
Really funny. Did it just shift behind you?
It did, didn't it? It's right there.
As you were talking, it was like right in the middle.
Perfect.
I thought I heard it before, but I wasn't sure.
The next thing is going to land right there. Crazy.
I knew, I saw that as well. I was like, they're going to go, aren't they?
Yeah.
Saving lives.
Engineering virality, I think it was, wasn't it?
Yes. So, I mean, I don't think it should be anyone's goal, really. And ultimately, that's because you have no control over the audience that it will reach. And for a business that's trying to sell a product or a service, going out and reaching a real wide audience of people who are predominantly not interested in what you're selling can be detrimental to your overall success on marketing and social in general, because you're going to have this wider audience, but they're not going to engage with every other post that you do because they only liked that one post for whatever reason that may be. So it's vanity metrics. Is what virality is, and it can be a really great quick fix for high engagement. It can look great, and it can be great if you kind of do hit that market, the right audience, which can happen. I'm not saying that, you know, but what I would say is you want to aim for high performing posts over virality. So a high performing post might not reach 6 million people, it might be kind of under 100K,
yeah.
But that might be a much more refined audience. Yeah. They might have that real interest in what you're doing.
Well, there's this, it's an age-old adage, it's not really, but it's the idea of having 1,000 loyal followers or something like that. They're always going to be better than people that will just watch a post and just ditch it, right?
Absolutely.
And I think on that kind of like transitioning into recent things that have either gained kind of like they're trendy to do, or just kind of like posts that have gone crazy. Of course, we've got the Huak Tuah girl,
mm-hmm.
which that's probably a thing of like kind of not necessarily bad virality, but it can completely change somebody's life, right?
Yeah, and it did.
And it did, yeah, for sure. What do you think of that kind of virality where someone just says something, I guess, natural in sense, but it can be taken in many other ways? What do you think of it?
I think, I mean, it's difficult, isn't it? Social, it's going to happen. People will make a meme out of anything they can. That's just what we're hardwired to do now in terms of content. And it's looking for those moments where you can create shareable content.
Yeah.
And that's what that is, because one of the most important metrics on social is the shareability of content. And what they look for in that is something that is got of comedic value, something that you would share to a friend because it's made you laugh. It's ultimately kind of sharing experiences. So what you would find really funny, you would then send to a friend because you know that that friend would find it really funny because you know them on that personal level, so you know what they're interested in, right? So
yeah.
it's interest-based. So any kind of goal with content really is creating shareability, because the more shares it has, the more the algorithm likes you and yada, 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 it goes on. So the thing with things like that is that, I mean, it was unfortunate for her because yeah. what a line to go viral.
Yeah, yeah.
And she has been on numerous podcasts now. And I mean, she's going to use that to her advantage.
And she's owned it, to be fair.
She has owned it. And she has said kind of, you know, look, I don't want to be known for that, but it's given me a platform that I can then kind of work out my next move on, which is great. And it can, I think if you're smart enough to use it to your advantage, it was unfortunate. I think she'll go down in history for saying that. it was a bit iconic, but
yeah, it's a bit funny these days when it comes down to like people who will go down in history, because you've got meme history in general,
yeah.
but like when the ancient Egyptians were writing the hieroglyphs and everything like that, it's just like, this is going to last forever, this is going to be history. And now we've got stuff like the Huak Tuah girl and a bunch of other memes that will just go down in history. And it's like, it's interesting to see how kind of like what's important has changed so
yeah.
kind of crazy, right?
It's changed so much.
Yeah.
Like she's made it onto massive billboards and all sorts, but also like I'm pretty sure she's copyrighted it now, so brands are now paying big bucks use her, which
yeah.
I mean, you know, like I said, use it to your advantage. How often do we say stupid things to our friends?
Yeah.
I mean, you don't always get to monetize the stupid things you say, so in that sense, good
yeah,
on
no,
her
definitely.
It's a great opportunity
and
for
it's
her.
Something because sometimes you find out these moments that have actually just been engineered
mm-hmm.
to be kind of like viral and stuff. But that's something that's quite clearly, that's just a pure kind of natural moment. One thing, there's this couple from Barry, actually. Do you know Kinging It? Do you know of Kinging It?
No,
they're,
I don't
they're
think
they're a YouTube like travel duo. They originally started their kind of content path through doing a fake news reading where this wave comes up and hits them and this fish hits this girl across the face. It's the what's it called, one of the guys from King in the face, and that became viral, and you know they owned it, shared the rights,
they
ran
with it. Sure.
The other thing that's become trendy recently is the 1 second post, which we did
mm-hmm.
talk about earlier. What's your opinion on that? Is it something good to follow? Is it something
I see, the thing is, I always have controversial opinions when it comes to these things, because for me, that is irritating. It's irritating, and I'm pretty sure a lot of social media managers, marketing managers will agree, because the problem is the fundamentals of what performs when you create a strategy for a brand, for a creator, things like that, will always remain the same, and they will always work. And having pillars of content and having structure and having strategy will always be important.
Yeah.
And what happens is you have these momentary kind of viral trends that take over, and they almost temporarily disregard your strategy.
Yeah.
Because they, if you don't engage with it, then you don't get to utilize the wave of that content, and you don't get to benefit from kind of the short-term engagement boost that is there. So if you use it to advantage, yes, it can be great. But the problem with these things continuously kind of coming up is that it just makes it so difficult to have consistency in a strategy, because it's you've got to be on your game all the time.
Yeah.
Because if you're not, you're going to miss these things all the time. And these things are just every day you wake up and something's changed or something new's popped up. So it makes it exhausting for us having to kind of be that reactive constantly and not being able to just let our strategies work, which they would if these things didn't pop up.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I have mixed feelings about it. Some of them are quite funny, though, I have to admit.
Yeah, well, your opinions are quite funny.
Oh, well, that too.
Probably that too. No, some of them are quite, of course, the
some
trends.
Of the videos.
They are quite funny. I remember back in the day when it was Facebook and it was just like a looped video of somebody about to chop an axe, and you just put in like, can't believe what happened once the axe breaks. Yeah.
Exactly.
So, it's crazy.
It's clickbait, and clickbait has always been a marketing tactic from day dot, and it's just continuously showing up in different forms. And that's essentially what it is people are finding new ways to clickbait.
Fair enough.
So that's all.
What are three things that you would recommend people when it comes to how they market it themselves?
Personal or business?
A lot of this will be content creators that will watch this, maybe some business, but more towards personal kind of content creator / people that want to build their social media, build a loyal following, let's say.
Know who you're trying to talk to first and foremost. It's regardless whether you're a business or you're a content creator, you're going to need to know your audience. So understanding who it is in you're trying to speak to, and by that I mean like one person.
Yeah.
Imagine that one person that you want, who you think would resonate with you the most, who would engage with your content the most, who would take the most value from it, who would buy your product, whatever that may be. You need to understand what they want in order to be able to connect with them. So ultimately, if you're trying to talk to everybody, you're not going to connect with anybody.
Yeah.
And that's just how it is.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people start kind of like aimlessly posting without having any idea of who they're trying to speak to. But of course, the way you speak to people would change depending on who that audience would be. So without understanding your audience, the tone that you show up with could be the reason that your content's not connecting. And it could be that your content is great, but ultimately, if you're not communicating it in the right way to the right people, then it's gonna flop regardless of how well you've produced it.
Yeah.
So being aware of that, I think it's a step that people skip really often. And it's one that I always have to take clients back to in the beginning of any strategy when we take them on, is their audience analysis. And it's something that if you ask them, so many people are like, oh, it is everybody.
Yeah.
And it's not. So I think that being kind of the first and foremost thing, then I would say that niching down, especially as a content creator, I think lifestyle brands can be great, but you have to be really good at kind of creating emotion.
Yeah.
So if you can't create emotion in your content, if you're not great at shooting video, if you're not great at understanding storytelling, then you're not going to create kind of enough emotion to keep people interested in your day-to-day life, because they're not really getting value out of that other than they're just watching you live. So if you're not living anything interesting, they're not going to stick around for it. So it's, if you're going to be a lifestyle creator, then you need to kind of really understand what kind of emotions you're invoking in your audience. If you're a beauty influencer, if you're any other kind of creator, and you're posting a bit of beauty, a bit of kind of lifestyle, a bit of fashion, you're going to struggle. So niching down is key, really, kind of connecting with that audience. Again, it comes back to audience. It comes back to what they really want. So yeah, try and kind of track over a period of time, whether it's a month or two, of what, if you are a kind of this or that poster, have a look at what you're posting, see what connects better, test some things out, and then from that niche down, and then just go hard with the bit that's performing the best, and then work on just excelling at that thing. And that's where you'll probably start to see, or you should hopefully start to see that community grow, because what they do is they start to understand what to expect from you. Mm-hmm. The other thing then is consistency, and people get confused by consistency because they often think that means they have to post every day, and that's just not the case. Consistency is whatever it looks consistent and realistic to you.
Before we finish off, okay, I actually got two questions for you. We just kind of started talking about it whilst Tyler was fixing the camera. What do you think of social media as a whole? Is it good? Is it bad?
Ooh, is that not like the golden question? Okay, I mean, I have mixed feelings about it.
Yeah.
Given that I work in it, it's like one of those things to kind of talk about. But there's good and bad to everything, and social is definitely one of them.
Yeah.
I think an overconsumption of social is exhausting mentally, and people need to understand how to look after their minds, and social can be really damaging to that. When you're aimlessly scrolling and you're kind of in these doom states, that can be a really dangerous place to be. Obviously, you've got the things like the self-comparison and the kind of, nothing on social is real, really. It's just not. Everything's edited, everything is manufactured to be great, to look wonderful, to engage, to connect. And I think ultimately it's remembering that, but I think that can be difficult for people. If you're not in a great place, it's very difficult for you to remember that everything is a highlights reel, essentially.
Definitely.
So I think in that side of it, it can be quite sad at times for that. And I think as a parent, the kind of raising children in a world of social is a scary thought.
Oh, massively.
Because they have so much access to so much that they wouldn't have at such a younger age.
Well, if you think even to like people like in our age, you know, it's compared to our parents, right?
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have access to the internet in some cases, and,
yeah.
you know, and all of this. Recently did a video on digicams, watch it here. And one of the things that came out of this digicam was a floppy disk.
I loved floppy disks.
Floppy disks are really cool.
They were great.
But I was talking to a friend, and apparently someone came up to him where he had some floppy disks at one point and said, "Oh, you 3D printed the save logo." And I was just like, oh my God, it just hurts, man.
That really hurts.
It really does.
That does hurt.
But to come kind of bring back to the point is, you know, when it comes to social media, it's a tool that can be used for good, it's a tool that can be used for bad, it's a tool that can be used for commerce as well, you know, which is what it, you know, what it dives down to is really money. You know, people are looking to earn money, and I hate to tell you this, we're looking to earn money off of this as well, but it's one of those things where, like, using it in the correct way, I think, is the most important. But it's never going to be like that.
No,
people are never going to use it the correct way. You are going to go viral for a stupid moment that happens to you. You know, things just happen. It's about understanding what you can do with it after, or understanding what you can do with it if you want to go that way as well.
You're ultimately relying on everyone to be morally correct.
Yeah.
If social was to be a great place, right? And that we know, you know, the events of the last week in the UK alone would tell you that people aren't morally correct. People aren't even sane. So expecting that to resonate on social is just a different kind of, it's just not going to happen. And I think just take it at face value. It is what it is. There are opportunities there. You can monetize on there. There are opportunities for brands, for personal on there. It is something that creates connection but also disconnection at the same time, and I think ultimately it's just have awareness, and that's probably the best approach you could take to it.
I'm actually adding another question in now,
okay,
because it was something I do actually need to ask, to be fair. How important do you think it is for people to have an answer, honestly? How do you think it is for people to have good equipment in creating content for themselves, marketing themselves and stuff like that?
It's becoming increasingly more important. I think you could get away with it even a couple of years ago, just doing everything on your phone. You can't do that now. I just think everyone's become so good at creating content because the generation that are growing up doing it, that are kind of, it's normal for them. Like, even my generation, we had to learn to do those things because it wasn't natural for us. it's now so natural for them that they're becoming better and better and better at it. And so they're investing in it because they know that they can reach better brands, they can reach better audiences by investing in their kit. So people are spending the money, which means that obviously the competition is more difficult. So I do think that an ability to invest in, well, invest in kit, but also invest in learning how to edit well. I think invest in the
it's one of the most important things is because you can have all the gear, but you can then also have no idea.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's not necessarily you need to learn every complex thing that's out there. When it comes to this kind of thing, and especially when it comes, we're actually out reviewing the ZVE 10 Mark II, so link up here or link at the end of the video. When it comes to it, Sophie's going to be in it. But it's not the cameras these days, and especially things that are designed towards creators. I mean, you see it with the Osmo Pocket 3, you see it with this. You don't need a massive understanding of the complexities of content creation.
No.
You need to just learn how to tell a story and how to engage and how to edit. I mean, editing is also important.
Absolutely. Videographers and photographers are, you know, never going to be beat out by a content creator off social for the pure fact that, like, you're right, they don't need to know that level of information on the technical side of it, because there is now the equipment that's there for you to just press record and go for it and upload. And that's essentially when you're creating social content, you need a lot more of it and you need it done faster. So you can't actually really afford, that was really weird. Sorry, but I had a really weird spasm in my leg.
Oh, no, don't worry about it. There you go.
There's your viral moment.
There you go, your viral moment. I was just like, what? Did something happen? Okay.
That was a really strange experience. I think that was my leg. Anyway. I don't know how we come back from this.
Oh no, it was all going running really well, very professional, and then suddenly, ah!
There's the reel.
There you go.
There's your reel. You can have that one for free. Yeah, bottom line is, you can do it with a very basic knowledge, but just make sure that that knowledge is good. And that comes down to being able to edit well, invest in the kit, invest in the systems to do it on, and the softwares, because it will level you up quite quickly for an affordable rate.
Yeah. Awesome. Last question now then is, what is your advice for people getting started?
In content creation?
In marketing, social? But it's basically these days, everyone really wants to become this quote unquote influencer. And that's not the best way to go into something like this, in my opinion. It's like, oh, I'm going to go in and become famous.
Yeah,
that doesn't
happen. Find something that you're really great at. Find something that is in line with your purpose, in line with who you are, so that it becomes easy to talk about. So you are easy to connect with and easy to resonate with, because people will see straight through you if you're trying to kind of orchestrate anything just to grow as an influencer. Like if you're not into fashion and all of a sudden all you're doing is posting outfit videos, it just transpires that. And it also becomes really difficult for you to create content and then boring. You fatigue easily because you don't want to create it because it's not something you actually have an interest in. So I think and everyone's got that thing that they love. So find what it is that you really enjoy talking about, that you talk about well, that kind of, even if it's things that you talk about with your friends and it's the one kind of topic that often comes up between you and a friend because you're great at talking about it or you love talking about it. For me, it's kind of business, it's mum life, it's kind of well-being. That's kind of all-encompassing of what I do day to day. So it's very easy for me to talk about those things. Naturally, obviously, social too. But
I've got cats.
I also have a cat.
The cat's great.
Cats are great.
Sorry, I feel like we're just going to get in a conversation about cats now.
It's Let's continue
with what you were saying.
I think do that because then you're not going to fatigue and it's going to become increasingly easier for you to kind of produce that quantity of content you need to become a quote-unquote influencer, which is not what anyone's goal should be.
No.
Monetize what you do really well.
Yeah, and that's it. And like when you said that, then we it's like it's not what your goal should be. Isn't that right? Sorry, I just heard someone screaming over there. It's like, what the fuck? We got somebody
giving me a run for my money.
Guys, we got a backup photographer. What was I saying? What did you just say?
Don't do it.
This is all these like little funny bits are going to play at the start, and then we're going to hit them with a knowledge bomb. It's like, poof, you learn. No, if anything, we can see by the structure of kind of like how people become influencers is a large percentage of the time, it's by mistake. It's sheer luck. It's not, you can work hard. And I believe that, you know, working hard is key to it becomes successful, right? Mm-hmm. But it's not like that all the time. People who have worked hard have sometimes had a chance for that to go viral. There are a number of influencers that I know of and that have become viral because they know somebody or they went out with somebody that, you know, and all of that. And it's a really interesting market, but don't have, like you said, don't have the aspiration to be famous. Just have fun with what you do. And that's the most important.
It happens by accident for so many people. Yeah. And it's usually, you're right, it's either that kind of vanity side of it where they know somebody who knows somebody, or it's because they've just started posting about something that they love and people enjoy watching it because it's authentic and people are buying into who they are, and then they can just monetize that. And if you monetize your, I always say this, if you chase money, you won't get very far. Mm. And if you chase your purpose and you work towards your purpose, whatever that looks like for you as a person, money will follow. Mm-hmm. And that's it.
Money will follow, like some creepy person. If you like this video, make sure you like, follow, subscribe. If you want to see more, put a comment in down there and I'll see if I'll pass the questions over and or answer them myself if I know anything. I feel like I've learned a lot today. I haven't really taught you anything, so you know, she's been the teacher, but it's been really good. Thank you for joining us today, really awesome. And
that's
finishing up, letting you have a play with a new camera.
Awesome.
But yeah, cool, awesome.
Thanks so much.